Everyone, thank you. Thanks so much for coming in on a Friday evening for a lovely lecture and an opportunity to welcome to the AA and at this podium Günther Vogt this evening, who's going to present an overview of recent projects and maybe relate those projects to many others that you will know that he and the studio have done over the years. His title tonight, Landscape as an Attitude, he's taken as an opportunity to really reflect on the idea of principles in architecture today, if not principles, what he refers to, as written about before, is the idea of archetypes that organize what we think of as the urban landscape. And you could say for something like a grand old institution like the Architectural Association that always wants to put the word architecture up front, most certainly the field of landscape urbanism is the most proximate of those many, many collaborative fields that don't sit side by side with architecture because of the words, but in fact have grown up as a discipline, and in a discipline that in the middle of the 19th century in this country came to life in unexpected ways and has grown and evolved alongside what we think of as the field of modern architecture or urbanism itself. And I think it's a fantastic and rare opportunity for us to invite in an absolute leader in a field as close to that of architecture and to show his thinking about the way in which that field relates to the world we know well in architecture. Vogt Architecture, a studio that's based in Switzerland, in Berlin, and of course has an office here in London, has worked worldwide on a combination of commissions, both public and private, in Europe, in Asia, in Switzerland, which is always somehow between those two destinations, and an absolutely incredible array of projects, and worked closely on the development of ideas that, and projects that you all know well. The surrounders for the Allianz Arena in Munich, the gardens surrounding the Laban Center here in London, the Laban Dance School, the Novartis campus for many, many years in Switzerland, Hadspin House in Dorset, not far from our Hook Park, and a project that features a remarkable array of modern architectural ingenuity held together on a thousand acre landscape that Günther in the studio has worked on. The studio has worked on the Tate Gallery here in London, the Athletes Village, is it a year or 2 years ago by now, in the Olympics, European Central Bank in Frankfurt, and on and on and on. Remarkable array of incredible projects, and beside those projects, of course, personalities that on their own are a different story altogether. Architects like Jacques Herzog and Pierre Demeron, Frank Gehry, Himmelblau, and again, many, many others. Günther trained as a horticulturalist initially and went on from that field of plants and their maintenance to landscape architecture, which he studied and established his office in Zurich in 2000 and quickly set up branches initially in Munich, now up in Berlin, before coming here to London. He is a professor at the ETH, where he teaches landscape architecture. His work and the studio's work has been the subject of exhibitions and publications worldwide, maybe two to highlight, both absolutely stunning Lars Müller books that I think you will know, Distance and Engagement in 2010, which followed on from a few years before Miniature and Panorama. As I said, tonight's lecture, Landscape and Attitude, and its attitudes is really an opportunity for all of us, I think more than anything, to see the way in which landscape architecture offers the topic of time as a genuine and real feature of those projects, and in fact, landscape architects are genuine masters of how projects unfold in time, and I think at a moment like this, when architects are over and over again trying to think through how architecture as a field can be something other than a singular object, final project obsession, and in fact being understood as the installation of spaces and structures that unfold in time, bringing a landscape forward to talk about that is an incredible chance. Günther, it's a pleasure to have you here. Thank you.
Thank you for the invitation. Thank you for the introduction. Landscape as an attitude, I would like to start a little bit to talk about teaching, because there are many students here, And I'm very critical with my students. I just had 4 days with my students, and I'm super critical with them, and they are sometimes influential to me. So what I'm saying is I'm teaching architects, landscape architects, that's really important for me, and I think for the students as well. And we at ETH, we have, of course, we have urban planning, urban designer, landscape architects, but in the end, everybody is an architect. And I have to say, I really like this idea. In the beginning, I was quite critical about it, but meanwhile, I think it's the best. Because architects have to learn a lot about landscape, about how to deal with landscape, and that's why I'm showing this. My problem is with teaching, I'm coming like Peter, coming from a from the medieval times, so meaning we draw by hand, and you are all drawing digital, and that's a real problem. When I'm teaching, I see that all professors at ETH are not able to draw one line in a computer, but all students are only using the computer. So they are all showing me this image, and they all think when they are working with landscape, it's land art. And it doesn't exist since Robert Smithson finished his work here, and he died here in 73. And since then, I think that was a period, and it's over. But all my architectural students believe that they are doing land art when they are coming to my courses, and then they can be artists and so on. But by the way, it's my photo done by iPhone last year. So I did this photo. I could talk now about two hours about this work. But what I'm explaining to the students that the world exists before they were born in the 1990 or late 1980s. That geology is somehow quite old, and the difference between 50,000 years and 150 million years is quite important when you deal with landscape. And that's interesting, this discussion. And I think teaching is now, I start to, the course is called Process Cartography, and we really try to explain to students how to deal with landscape. And it's the first time, so they are mostly master course students, they have to learn how to, in a way, to work, not to design landscape, but to work with landscape. And so we ask them, it's a bit like a geographer, so that's why we are using this expression cartography. And what is the difference between an analytical process and a design process? So we have constantly to explain them what is really important in a landscape. And so we start with group work, so they work as groups together and analyze the landscape, and in a historical sense, in a natural science sense, in whatever is important for this part of the landscape. And again, I'm stressing here a little bit that we are doing our work at the beginning and the initial work in an analog way. So what we found out, we prepared all these super good field trips and did all the work for them. But meanwhile, our students have to plan their field trips themselves and to show in advance what is the planning of the field trips. And then, of course, we are stressing them to decide in the beginning what are the tools of design, like here a photo in a small Alpine Italian city, Tirano, where one student was impressed by looking out and looking in the city, and you can imagine finally he designed here the central area, the empty space in this small town. And from the beginning, he was fascinated by this space. And when I'm talking about mapping, when I was in Harvard, students were really crazy. They were so great in mapping, constantly mapping. I had a student who produced in the semesters 280 maps, but no design, only mapping. What I found here, by the way, in London, is silk. for English soldiers in India, so a silk map of Burma. And so this problem of digital and analog was so present to me when I was with my students in Rome in front of the Colosseum. One of the students made a photo of the Colosseum with iPhone and flashlight. And then I told her, listen, you are really like a cheap tourist. As an architect, you always relate to the environment, to the built environment or non-built environment. And now we are designing a rucksack for architects. So where they have all things, and it came then, and then we stress them, and now it's a really design process in the office where we showed them. So for instance, this very famous Caravaggio painting, what is behind? This painting is in the end a collage, because you can see here and here, it's a completely wrong scale in terms of perspective. This painting is a collage of about 25 different sketches he brought together. And it's completely wrong in terms of a really correct perspective. And so we found out we have to bring the students, in, especially in a landscape, in a position where they can perceive landscape. And so we did the first test in one of our meeting rooms in the office, and we made a complete black room out of it with a small hole, and what you can see after 10 minutes being in a black room, you can see the outside inside. So we did the same then with the students, that they really learn how to perceive landscape, and we did the same in a car or here in with a did it the first time, and that's interesting to find out that what appears then afterwards in the cabin to isolate the students in such a space, especially architects, they have a space in the landscape, and then it really works. They really understand what is the difference between a building and the landscape. And of course, again, when I'm talking about teaching, you don't believe, besides a teacher of drawing, pencil drawings, we have to give now course, digital course, that's completely new. I couldn't believe that I have to offer a course in digital medias. It's just amazing. I couldn't believe, because they are not able to use all the data. CTH has data, unbelievable data, but they don't know how to deal with it, I understand, because I have constant discussion with my students. They have no courses in digital media. And that's my problem in teaching. We left it, for instance, especially in ETH, 5 years ago, we stopped this idea of the Bauhaus, where you had in the first year a really courses for design skills. But I think one can stop all this kind of teaching, but then you should replace it with something. And I think all university architectural schools stopped this European idea of the Bauhaus to have design skills in the first years, and afterwards you explore your ability to design. But in this digital analog discussion, we forgot to replace something. So we have to bring back these skills in a digital, even in the digital world. And that's why I only work in Europe with my students, not like some of my colleagues in Rio or in Mumbai, wherever, and I know you do it here, but the problem is that our students coming from, I don't want to be too critical, from a provincial background, grown up in a single house, and then they come in the first course. We are telling them, listen, the way you live is completely wrong. The style you lived is completely ugly. And then, after 3 years, we go to Mumbai with them, not understanding the European city or what is the idea of European or what is the idea behind London. So we start globally, and I think that's completely wrong, because they don't understand. It's not only about the landscape, like here, the Alps. We all in Switzerland, we relate to the Alps, and the Alps are, by the way, an English idea, because the Swiss didn't go up to the mountain. It was too dangerous, so it was an English idea. And for me, the Alps are somehow a park. It's very English, no? Because you see all the cities are around the Alps. So the red line is the area of the Alps with the mountains, the forest, and so on. But all the cities relate, like where our universities like Zurich, they all relate to a big park in the center. And then we try to explain the students, and you have the same with Zurich here. You see a wonderful situation with the lake. And I'm the only one in Zurich saying, for the Zurich people, the lake is the park in here. And then, of course, my assistants are saying, Günther, you're right, but not right now. Within 10 years, it will be like that. Then I did a test with the students, and the students asked 286 people, what is the lake for you? Could you draw your lake? And you see what these 286 people have drawn. It's, some people said, it's just what I see from my apartment. So the hills behind, or the, and it was a really long research we did. What is the lake? And you see even here what the lake for them is. So it's the neighborhood, it's the whole environment around the lake. And why I'm showing this, the Alps and the Lake of Zurich are two completely different scales. And that's, in landscape architecture, one, today I think the biggest problem is that we are not discussing enough what is the right scale. Meaning, there is a big park, the Alps, and it's like a neighborhood park, this is the Lake of Zurich. And so we should discuss much more about the scale, and that's the influence more from the geographers and from the landscape architect, that it's important in the beginning to discuss what is the right scale, what is the intervention we are doing here. And that's five theses, by the way, we found out through this research. These are really the topics we have to work with our students. So the rivers, the street, agriculture, what kind of park do we expect, and the forests. And not designing landscape or land art project, but these are the five elements in the Swiss culture we have to deal with, in the small or in the big scale. And then here we ask our students to define the programs. That's another problem. In you as architects, you know you're constantly involved in programmatic discussions, and in landscape architecture, the program is really not existing. So when we have a big competition, so they are asking 500 bike parking, and so this kind of thing, but that's not a real program. So they have to find out their individual program, and we agree to it, like here when we explain it's a Nolli plan in Rome, to what is a public space, and they have to define what is a public space for them, for me, and then they always look at me and then say, okay, I give you my definition. A public space is 24 hours accessible, you don't have to pay, you don't have any cameras controlling you, and all this kind of thing. And here you see Rome in the old days, in the Nolli time, where all churches were public spaces. Today it would look completely different because the churches are closed on night time. And then this discussion is really difficult with the students, because they really have to understand what is it. And we course you cannot read it now, but we ask them for a title, three sentences, and a short text to describe what is my idea in what is the idea behind my design in the next semester or in the following semester. And it's not so easy for them, and we really have to help them, even in writing. Writing seems to be very difficult, but it's a real help for them to have this idea of a background of explaining. And then, of course, we have this discourse on tools. What are the tools you're working with in your design here, where we explain photography? You see the same here on Buff, it's a piece of the natural sciences, and then it can appear somewhere here the same photo as a piece of art. And then really to discuss, are you interested to work with photography? If you work with photography, you have to do it in a serious way. And then we prepare them with them. We offer them a system of maps, here analog maps, and digital maps as well, where they have to fill in their analytical results. So all students can then share the analyze work from the other students. And so it's a really growing box of different analytical studies. For instance, we are now working, one group is working on symmetries and all over Europe, so every student group is analyzing a different or a more architectural symmetry, like Aldo Rossi's Modena project or Père Lachaise in France. And so we have like a growing box on our own server. And of course, we teach them this sketching and, super important for us, always the model. And the model is a real problem for the students. I can really understand it because they can only use it once. But we in the office, we can use it 15, 20 times. And for a professional studio, it's much more efficient. For a student, it's not so easy. But CTH is famous for the model working tradition. They really understand now, they don't only have to build a model in for buildings, but for landscape as well. So we really help them then to find out the right technique. And finally, development and communication. So our students, we have to bring them to the point that they really understand. We want to see all sketches, all steps they did during the work, and that's the work of one student here, and here is the analytical work from all students, quite a long wall. So he can in this case, he can relate to the analytical process and explain his whole project. And everything has to be on the wall. It can be this case, he wanted to work finally only analog, so he can do it. But if somebody wants to work only digital, he can do it as well. So it's but we want to have it present finally. And of course, we do our job as well, so we have communication, so we always produce this kind of newspaper for the students, for the other students, and even going to the public if it's like here, it's in a small town, so we announce it in the public and we have a blog so everybody can react on it, that our students really understand you cannot work in the public space without having communication with the public. And that's really important for them to understand. And of course, we we have to teach them architects have to eat in a good, you know, in a good way. I always invite them because they don't have enough money. So, and then we organize this kind of, here it was tasting cheese, different cheese. But we did it with not only because it's Switzerland, we did it with oil, olive oil, and all all different kind of things. And then we arrange this kind of debate around the kitchen table. We just had it last 2 days ago. So where we learn them somehow, how can we discuss problems? And it, As you know, it's difficult for young people to design an apartment. I think it's for an architect, architectural student's most difficult thing, because he grew up in a family, he was a boy or a girl, but when he has to design an apartment, he has to be in the position of the parents. And the same thing is when they can really not understand how an apartment, how a family works, how it works, because they were in a completely different position. And the same is when they have to design a kitchen, they are not able to design a kitchen because they never cooked. So we teach them really to sit around together, and it's really, so because they mostly live alone somewhere in an apartment in Zurich, so to sit together and to talk together. And in the beginning it's always a bit difficult, but with a bit of wine and beer it starts to become. And then we start about what is public space in your project, and they have to learn to talk about their project. So how does this all influence our work in the three different offices? I show you two projects in here in London, one in Hamburg and one in Switzerland. The first more to be a bit critical about these big events here. As you know, it's in East London, so the Aslett village, as it was before. Oops. For us, always interesting to work in London or in England, this quality of maps you have. It's amazing. For me, it's such a wonderful country. It's perhaps of your colonial history, so you always needed really good maps of the landscape. And then we got always the best maps you can find, even better than in Zurich. They are more beautiful drawn in Switzerland, but here they are much more interested in England. So we always start with this mapping, and I cannot show you the whole analytical process. You know it in East London with this history of the railways and before now the Olympic Village or the Olympics were built, and the master plan. It's all not so interesting for me. That's as way I didn't see it until now. I wasn't allowed to go in. I don't know why, but Irene, perhaps you can explain it afterwards. That's about public spaces. No? So that's a designer. I saw photos, and I will show you photos, but I don't really know whether it's really built or it is digital. So the concept is quite simple. It's along the River Lee, and it's more this kind of ecological rainwater treatment idea, and the red-brown one, more the urban typology. And then, of course, you have a master plan of the Olympics, where you get the Olympics against Paris in this case. But sometimes I don't trust this kind of big events, because you always have this kind of urban planning, and you all know it. And then we are doing our design. You see here this more rainwater-related park, and then traditional park here, another one here, another one here, and the plaza here, small neighborhood park here. But the problem is with these big events, so you have this railway station foreseen to be the railway station for the Eurostar connecting London with Paris. A lot of investment, but now it will not happen. And everybody told me that London will be super sustainable, but we as urban planner, as architects, sometimes I don't believe to all these big events, and I'm not sure whether the calculations, the economic calculations really true. And then we just discussed it before arriving here, economy in landscape architecture, in urban planning, is somehow not really working. It doesn't really happen that we are talking about economy, and I think in the future we will have to talk much more about economy in a more, not really the building costs, but in terms of what is the real economy. Because we are constantly talking about sustainability, but behind sustainability is somehow economy. Let's see some landscape types, and what we found around is a context. And so here's a photo, sets a placeholder landscape, because there will be another high building, one of these central parks. So it's a high point on one of these hills. But why it was for me just an introduction. Afterwards, we had this legacy, this master plan, what happens after the Olympics. And of course, we are all talking about connectivity, waterscapes, programs, variety of atmospheres, waterfront, this kind of somehow abstract, neutral words. But finally, when we started to work on it, we looked around. And of course, we have this really old tradition of English landscape, the English landscape garden. And of course, here, looking out here in Bedford Square, this wonderful network of open space. But compared with the River Lee Valley, we cannot deal with this type of open space you have here in central London. But it is, most of the time, when we start somewhere in this big scale, the design or the program or the idea is already there, because here it was obvious for us that the system of all these waterways, and when you look on this water and it's here, you can go to Liverpool, to Manchester from this point, because you have so many canals leading you out of London, so a real system of canals. So when you look at it, there is already a park. You don't have to design a park in a way. This is the park. You have to take fences away, walls away, to establish promenades, all these kind of types. You don't have to design a really big park, because the park is already here with this wonderful system. And that's the way we designed it, with the different promenades along the canals and rivers, and linear small park systems, not really big, huge, large extended parks, but more along these waterways. And then, of course, smaller pocket parks, and where you have playgrounds and football and whatever you need, sports park. And then it's somehow easy. And of course, you have to have something, a wilderness area in England, always, because it's your landscape, has to be wild. And we found a lot of wilderness around here, and it is present, it's present, and to keep it, it has to be in a different scale, not a small scale, but really a big scale. And then the connections, the streetscapes and plazas are quite small. And we thought it's not so important to have this kind of traditional, let's say, European or Mediterranean types of open spaces, but relating to the existing Victoria Park and to the existing system, only connect the existing system to a new one. And then that's the integrated master plan. And that's how we work, and of course there is a lot of analytical work behind and a lot of design work as well, and to go there, and I think that's important, you have to know the site quite well, especially if it's such a big site, you have to understand what's going on here, and then field trips are the only chance to get connected to it as a designer. And that's what we wanted really to keep, this wonderful idea going on in East London, a lot of sports activities, but not this kind of event sports, but really on weekends, on the evening, sports of the end. Again, here, this is the existing atmosphere, not to destroy, not to be romantic or cynical, but to keep somehow the existing atmosphere, because that's why it's so interesting. So next one, in London on the other side, so we were in East London, now it's in West London. It's a work perhaps you know it, it's here is Heathrow Airport. It's a work with the architects McCranor Lavington here in Carmody Rock and Arup in London, a really good work here. Heathrow, here is this rectory farm, farm land, but abandoned today. And again, the question for us was, what is the scale relationship to the rest of London? And you see it's a bit an abandoned landscape. And it relates, of course, when you are talking about scale, it relates somehow to the greater London area, to the Green Belt. And of course, again, for me, coming from Switzerland, it's amazing to have in a city like London a map saying whole of London is underlaid with a landscape type map. It would never happen in Zurich that we would get such a map for Zurich, for instance, where the landscape types, that's a very British idea. But I have to say, it's interesting that you still think that there is an existing landscape under the built city. And of course, in a smaller scale, we relate, so when we are talking about the rings, the big scale, we are somehow here relating to a sequence of different traditional parks. So this system and this system is coming together. And why is this park there? That's easy when you look at on the geological map. It's a gravel, it will be or should be a gravel excavation. And when you have such a big, this scale is quite large, it's such a big scale, we worked quite a long time not designing anything. And I think it's important in the beginning, you have to have not only an idea, but here you have to follow different strategies. I mean, political, social, and to dig out gravel, you have a soil. Have to have a soil management to bring many trees here, a vegetation management, so water system, rainwater, the drainage system. So you need different strategy because it's such a big scale. And then you have to find out what is really important. For instance, here it's more related to the neighborhood. I don't explain it in detail. And then again, you have to do your homework. That means your field trips. You cannot relate to the big green ring of London without knowing it. And it's by bike or by walking. You have to really understand what is the atmosphere, what is the quality behind this already existing or still existing landscape. And that's why we thought to have two different scales, so this local park or the neighborhood park, and the whole park should relate to the Green Belt and the city. I'm not explaining the design because it's not really design, it's finally after a year, so it's only showing the strategy we are working with, so different scales, the smaller scales, the more intimate scales, the large scale. And of course, underneath there will be a space. That's a proposal by the engineers to drill holes, and then you would have poles on top, and then we would build the part from the beginning, and afterwards they would start the excavation here for 25 years, and they would get a space for free somehow. But again, when you see such a project or such a design of for the next 25, 30 years, their economy is quite important. That's Amazon, and it's I don't know how many times bigger our space will be underneath, and there the economy, what will happen in such an architecture, such a big structure underneath. And as I mentioned already, so we worked on a strategy how to bring so many trees in here. Could there be production, like a tree nursery, so we produce our own trees on site. And then what I mentioned before, so to go out and to define, when we are talking about different types of landscape, you can find them everywhere around London, so this woodland and parkland system, or this for the different edges, so they are, have different atmospheres. And we could find all types in and around London. And of course, I'm not talking about the water system. It's quite a complex system of water management. And then finally, it fits into this neighborhood and into the big system. But it's not finally designed, I would say. So we really have to work a lot on the design still. So it's... And his role is here somewhere. So the next is Hamburg, the Lose Park. It's again, it's completely different what we see approach here, and because it's in the former harbor of Hamburg, and the Elbphilharmonie is here. It's the biggest urban development in Europe now, and. Our park is in the Elbphilharmonie is here, and our park is here. So it's the biggest park of this development in the Hafen City. And of course, the context today, it looks like a former industrial area, quite ugly, but quite dynamic. And for us, it was important to work in Hamburg. A specific city for us in Germany, they have a long history, and we believe, for instance, here, it's really the contribution of the German landscape architecture to the landscape architecture. Leberecht Migge, who worked with the political left-wing architects in the 1920s, and he introduced this kind of Volkspark, and so keep it open for everybody, don't keep people out of our park, public parks. And so, and Schumacher as well, another one, an urban planner in Hamburg. So there is this kind of a memory of a city. And for us, it was this tradition of, let's say, a bit traditional parks, but really robust, and you can really use it. And it sets a tradition in Hamburg. So we started to work with this idea of the Volkspark. So it's a long, long park in here, and we have again four different levels. So it's the city level, it's the parking park level, and the historical level. So that's the historical level. It's a former railway station. I will show it afterwards. And then the level of the park is 1.5 meters below the city level, and then the city level here. What you see here, yellow, red, and dark red. So really relate to this new neighborhood, because there was, of course, no real history besides this element. Completely flat, because it was a former harbor, and now we have a completely new type of building. Here's the Spiegel building, this newspaper, and the Elbphilharmonie is somewhere here. Here's the three different levels. So you have the level of the city and the park level as a town. And you see it's very large. And as always, and you see we are building and we are showing it to our students, huge models here, it's about 8 meters long. And so we use it for photos, of course. Instead of renderings, we can use them for photos. And within this traditional, it's quite a traditional park concept, where you have a middle axe, so you can still feel this former harbor. It's very, very long. And small follies within these parks, and a specific planting, of course, with the trees. So, again, one folly is a wilderness, and the end is a special stair. And we proposed for all these, for the city levels, this kind of terraces with a special brick, because it's relating. And again, now when we have this concept, we really start to develop it, and the real design, what you normally see, is then coming in the development and communication. So we use the brick from Peter Zumthor used in Cologne for the Columba Museum. We used a similar brick from the same company to build this stair, this huge stair near the university. That's the first part, a small part just opened, and the big part of the park will be built in the next 2 years. So on then this historical level, perhaps you have to read this. So there was a railway station where some trains were leaving to a concentration camp in Eastern Europe in Poland. So it was somehow part of the competition when we won the competition, but it's always difficult in Germany with this kind of history. And then they exclude it because it could be in the newspaper when you do something not so okay, whatever. And meanwhile, it's in. And I told our client, the really important sentence is this one. If you understand this text, you don't need any art installation, whatever. It explains everything. So that's how it looks today. Just, it is from a railway station, a small railway station. That's reality. And here, the crime happened. So we said, okay, if you are talking about memory, we shouldn't destroy reality. And so that was the first sketch. So really say, okay, don't work with art or with land art. It's a cut-in, it's an existing cut-in. And for the students, our client gave us a job because of this watercolor drawing. He found it so poetic and so self-explanation, so that he found, you're really able, Peter Cook is able to draw like this, we are working with him, and he is able to draw like this, and we got the job because of his drawings. It's quite a big additional project, and only because he found it is so poetic. It's about, you're talking about reality and its memory, and of course we did afterwards all this research about material, but it's really this explanation saying it was so brutal, this history, you don't need this kind of Denkmal, this kind of memory building or an art installation, but just show the reality and frame it, and that's it. And one of the folly I show a little bit, so we found out we would like to work with geology. We introduced, instead of a traditional children playground area, a grotto, so where we deal with the idea of this geology, like a little bit like Gordon Matta Clark, to drill holes into the landscape and to talk about this geology. It's like a cave a little bit. And it's somehow, it's a grotto, it's for all of us, for our age, but it's in the same time, in a different time of the day or a different time of the week, it can be used by kids, and we don't offer anything else besides this material, clay, sand, whatever. So it's both, it's a grotto, it's a traditional park element, but it's a playground as well. So I mentioned it before, so it's this history, we relate to this history of famous colleagues, landscape architects, urban planners, but when we have to decide how to build, so we relate it to this brickwork, and we found for the staircase it can be easy, but for these terraces, for these urban terraces, we developed our own brick. Sometimes I don't know why architects are not designing more bricks, especially here in England, you have wonderful tradition. So we did our development work, and that's a one-to-one mock-up with our brick, so that's the terrace, and then that's the balustrade, and then on top of it. So it was a long work, of course. It's not really efficient in terms of fees, but it's wonderful work to deal with the city, with the history of the city, with the idea of material. So the last one in Basel for the Novartis campus, again, Basel as a campus in Basel is a collection of different architects, a master plan by Vittorio Lampugnani, and a collection of all architects you can imagine. So Sana, Raphael Moneo, Tadao Ando, Herzog de Meuron, and so on, 25 meanwhile. And of course, landscape architects as well, it's the same. It's just on the border of France behind Germany and Switzerland. And it is a transformation of a former industrial area into a scientific campus. It's about, so scientists will work there, finance people, marketing people, all these kind of things. And the starting point was with an English colleague. She was asking, and we produced a book, Distance and Engagement, together. She asked me, why are in Basel all pebbles in the River Rhine so different? And then I showed her this map of the Swiss geology, because the River Rhine is going through all these geological layers. That's why the stones are all so different. And then we did an unbelievable analytical research about Basel. We could publish at least 4 books about this research we did there, but it's what's more. It's not only for this project, it's more because we like it. And we found out that there are so many elements in the city of Basel relating to the former landscape. It's such a rich landscape, and the history here is so rich, and Basel is much more interesting than Zurich, because there was the biggest Celtic settlement in Europe around here. And why is the river shaped like this, the River Rhine shaped like this, and so on. And we found so many things, like the terrace relating to the glacial times, about 20,000 years ago. We could find it everywhere in the city, and here and there, and to understand there were some names saying the terrace, and then we found the boulders, the erratic stones, and cut-ins relating to the old history. And again, here some field trips outside Basel where we looked at the vegetation, and sometimes to explain ourselves, what do you see, and then make photos, what does it mean in a plan? What does it mean in a model? So when you really deal with a model or with a plan, that you have this image and you exactly understand what are we talking, when we are, because we are always designing in teams, when we are talking about a forest, do you mean a really dense forest or a light forest? And what does it mean when you draw it or in the models? And of course, I cannot teach architects vegetation, that's a real problem. Jacques Herzog is constantly criticizing me, but that's too difficult. It's not architectural studies, definitely not long enough. But our students have to describe, they have to learn to describe. They cannot just copy and paste a tree in a plan. They have to describe me, what kind of tree do you imagine? And then they always look at me and then I say, okay, you stay under the tree, do you see the sky or do you don't see it? Okay. And then they start, of course, and they have in May, they have to flower in purple, and in September they have to bloom white, whatever. But if some of the students are really good, together with me describing their idea, I translate it into a botanical and a scientific name, and they have really good projects, believe me. But only it's their design, and I can translate some missing knowledge. And I'm only, because there are so many students here, so we are constantly working in different medias. Here as well, we worked with digital medias, with sketching, with models, and here, by the way, that's when we started designing, we built these models that we found out here is the River Rhine, here is the entrance, and through all these works, it was the design. We didn't design it in a proper way, so we had this terrace system leading down, and then these cut-ins and this relation to the river, and we wanted to show a dense forest here and relating to the neighborhood. And in the end, it was designed. We didn't really design it, and we could really starting in the model, and then it was easy to find the right shape. And here's the wall studies, these cut-ins into the landscape. And then, if you have this kind of ideas, it's not so easy to build it. And that's sometimes with this, my digital colleagues, it has to be built somehow. And then to get closer to it, and that's, therefore, you really need a model of a workshop to find out. So for instance, it took us 6 months to find out we shouldn't build it like that, but it has to be built as an embankment along the River Rhine. So it has to be a completely different construction. We wanted to build it like stone, like architects. But then we found out it's easy. We have to build it completely different. And then with our contractor, we found out how to build these embankments. And it was a bit longer and a bit not so. It looks easy now, but it's really he is destroying this concrete wall, and he's like an archaeologist taking out the material and then. And of course, it doesn't look, it's not parallel. And because, again, we are in Switzerland, everything is on a car parking. So I forgot to tell you. So it's of course, not in relation the horizon to the horizon or to the river. It is like that. It looks like an embankment of the glacial times. And again, when we are talking about model making, it's wonderful to have clients building a model of the park, and here is the embankment, here's the sauna building. And if the client and we agree, you can keep it, and we could keep it. And again, you see it here, that was the starting point, and that's a drawing. And I explained it here, the dense forest, and then it's going down the terraces, the River Rhine here, and the cut-ins here. And again, car parking, but I have to say I'm meanwhile quite happy to have a car parking under our parks, because then they are safe. Otherwise, we are planning a small park. We just finished it 5 or 6 years ago. Meanwhile, a wonderful small park, but now there is no car parking underneath. We have to destroy it and to rebuild it on top of this car park. So since that's why I'm meanwhile quite happy to have a car parking underneath. Then some images. Here's the terraces, and our idea was, because the car parking is flat and the terraces are going up, and everybody's telling me, we are going down. They are not going down. They have the idea or the impression they are going down because the terraces are going up. So that's a bit the trick. And of course, you can never build it such a outside Switzerland. You cannot build it. It's 3.5 meter high, and the highest position without handrail, without fence. That's only in Switzerland possible, because Switzerland is a dangerous landscape. And so people understand you if the health and safety manager says, yeah, you shouldn't treat it as a lawn, perhaps a bit of meadows, and everybody knows there's a meadow after the lawn, then it's okay. So 3.5 meter, it's really, but we will lose it in Switzerland. I'm not talking today, but about art. That's a work by a friend of mine, Dan Graham. So we like to integrate artists' work, and but we are, again, we are not artists, but we like to work with them. All on top of a car parking, And you can imagine it's not 40 centimeters, it's a bit more. So these trees can really grow. And when I'm talking about communication, I had to explain this park in front of 800 Novartis employees. And then I showed this kind of photos. And of course, everybody asked, do we really have rabbits in our park? And then I said, what do you mean? Is it a real rabbit? And then I said, do you think whether it's a rabbit is alive or not? And so it's a stuffed rabbit, exactly. It's only for this photo. So to have a communication and then to have a bit, because I told the people it's so difficult for me to explain you as people using this park, what is behind the park. To explain you here is okay, but to explain people using it is a bit stupid for me. Then again, I think it's important, and landscape architects finally don't do enough, so the architectural museum asked us to explain, as always, architects ask us, how do you work? And so we opened up, we brought our office to the museum, so where you see all the maps and my personal private Wunderkammer, all these kind of things, where I explain to the students the difference between texture and structure. And so we dealt really with this architectonical idea. One room was the library here, and then the Wunderkammer, and then the cinema where we showed film with a special space. And again, you see when you build these big models, if there are some landscape architects in the room here, all architects and all clients have always to come to your office. It's really good, because then you don't have to travel. And it's in Zurich, we have huge models in our office underneath. And then they are all coming together in our office. And I think it's really important that you have, as a landscape architect, and there are, in this case, different architects with different buildings around our landscape project. So to bring people together in the landscape model, and everybody's discussing around the model, nobody's discussing about the drawings. Everybody relates directly to the model. And so the last one, because I started explaining it's not land art, an exhibition. Sometimes we do exhibitions, so now we are preparing one with Dan Graham. This was one with Olafur Eliasson in the museum in Bregenz by Peter Zumthor. So he invited me to collaborate, and then I asked him, but what would you like to do? What would you like to show? Because I don't want to be an artist, I can be an advisor to you as an artist. And then he told me, you know, I would like to work with landscape, with gardens, with parks. And then I started the discussion with him. You are talking about completely different things. It was a really good discussion, and I learned a lot from the artists and the architects about different things. One is about communications. This was the invitation card, and we, Olafur asked me, you have to be present in a public discussion about art. And then I said, but listen, I'm not an artist, I don't agree, because I cannot talk about art. And then, wait, I will manage it. And then it was a really wonderful discussion, because this was the invitation map. The first question was, why did you show this natural catastrophe or disaster as an invitation map? And then Olafur asked me, is it a natural catastrophe? And then I said, no, it's a cultural catastrophe. The water is coming because of we have too much asphalt in the Alps and concrete and so on. And so we really started a good discussion. And that's what I learned as the artist, to be open for this discussion. And so we transformed. Finally, I told him, you have no chance against this architecture by Peter Zumthor, absolutely no chance. You have, if you work in the space or something on the wall, you will lose. So you can only do something on the floor. Otherwise, you lose completely. But then he wanted to do something on the wall, and that's the entrance space, and you see Swiss concrete. And these are trunks with mushrooms, and in this cuts every day mushrooms grew out and they were stolen every day. Just in front of the reception, we could never find out who has stolen it. And then Olafur did an interview in a newspaper saying these mushrooms are poisonous. And of course, the guy who has stolen it knew it's shiitake. It's, you can buy it in every supermarket. But again, it was this exchange with the public. And I think that's interesting that even artists are interested in this public perception and exchange. Then Peter wasn't so happy what we did there, I have to say, because Olafur wrote in the introduction text of the catalogue, why is it so difficult to deal with architects? Why do they constantly build this kind of museums not relating to art? It's so difficult to show art. And so he wasn't really happy to read this. And we transformed his staircase. So to have a different perception of the different visitors, seeing the space always, you know, normally it's concrete and light coming above. So we changed the scale of the staircase. So, and the first mediated motion was the title. The first, we built a catwalk in the first floor and brought in some water and some plants. So by walking above, it was constantly making a little bit like that, the water, and you had to concentrate on yourself, and you see nothing on the wall. The next floor, rammed earth or compacted earth, but like that. So you see it a bit, here is zero, and where we are staying here, it's plus 1 meter. So it's really like that without catwalk on top. So you had to find your way through this second floor. And the last floor, it appears against the catwalk. You can see it again, ending in the wall here. And finally, you could see all people using the hands because it was the end. And it was the climate, was the ventilation. So instead of taking air out, we blew fog in. So all this phenomenon you can find in a traditional landscape. I couldn't believe how people liked fog. Of course, here everybody liked fog. But here in Bregenz in Austria, or close to Switzerland, nobody likes fog. But inside the museum, they all like it. If you show a landscape inside a building, it's completely different than you see it outside. And this, again, about this perception, I'm quite grateful to the architects and the artists. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Günther, for the interesting lecture and for let us get insight to your design methodology. I think we have time for questions. So if you have questions, please ask. Do we have a mic? Or?
Thanks. Hello. Can you hear me? Hello? Thanks for your lecture. I'm interested that a lot of your projects were based in cities. Mm-hmm. And I'm interested to know how you define your realm, the realm of the landscape architect, as opposed to that which is landscape and that which is urban. Mm-hmm. So is landscape that which is green? Or is Heathrow Airport a landscape because it's on a similar scale to the park? How do you define that now that there seems to, or is there a distinction at all?
No. So there is definitely no distinction, at least let's say in Europe and or let's say in the Western world. I don't see any difference because I would say we can only talk about different density of urbanization. And even in Switzerland, everything is urbanized. I could show you wonderful landscapes. You would say it's a landscape, but underneath you have the longest tunnel of the world. And everywhere, it's only a question of the gradient of urbanization. And I think it's about urbanization. But for me, what's interesting, we are meanwhile more interested in abandoned landscapes. For instance, the European Union is saying within the next 15, 20 years, Europe will get more than five times Switzerland abandoned landscape. And then I told my students, yeah, we have to think about it. And what do you mean? But what is it? Is it then just a forest? Mm-hmm. We are architects, urban planners, and we are constantly complaining that the world is completely urbanized, it's all gray and concrete and so on. But in reality, do you know how many million square kilometers have grown in Europe the last 30 years? I couldn't believe. You know. The surface of forest coming back, and we see it, especially in Italy, you see really regions completely abandoned. I saw villages in forest. You know. It's close to Torino in the north, but even in the south, whole regions, all villages completely empty, meanwhile overgrown by forest. And my question is, everybody stands saying, yeah, Bob, we keep it. And then I say, but we have to have an idea. Because if you keep it like that, so an investor will come within 20 years and say, okay, we have a village here, we transform it now in a touristic resort or so, or is it a national park? Or what is it? What are the rules of the games? And it was urbanized and it will be re-urbanized. And we have to think, and it's only a question of urbanization. And then there is this wonderful painting from Siena showing the city and showing the productive landscape outside. But in Western Europe, it doesn't work. It's really, we are all living in an urbanized landscape.
Yes, I think a lot of architects, including particularly rather clever architects, are able to develop ideas through degrees of abstraction. And yet, if one is in your field, tactility seems to be something which is very difficult for us to discuss sometimes, yeah, without sounding over-romantic. And most, you know, you mm-hmm. make a lecture, the lecture uses visual means, you talk about teaching, but I think mm-hmm. also in teaching, we very rarely talk about the qualitative aspect of the materials. Mm-hmm. And of course, we also are interested, people like myself are also interested in the symbolic mm-hmm. value of materials. That if one sees a large area of asphalt, mm-hmm. you know, you don't have to go to Belsent mm-hmm. to see the rails. You know, you see a large area of asphalt, you think of military conditions. You see a large area of marble. You think of pomposity, if you're mm-hmm. my generation. If you see large areas of brick, you think of a sort of homeliness or a sort of Northern European thing, and so on and so forth. But there's also the actual tactility of things, mm-hmm. the thing that in certain materials echo. Other materials are nice to roll on or sit on. Other materials are nice to the foot. Mm-hmm. And as you get older, you're more aware of materials mm-hmm. that are nice to the foot. Mm-hmm. And then we have also this issue now where in many countries, installations are made on the floor to deal with people who are partially sighted. So there's another level of tactility comes in. I'd be intrigued to know, because you're obviously highly sensitive in how you approach things, what you feel about that. Can it be quantified? Do you have loves and hates within it? Mm. Do you have means of representation with it? Do you have means of, how do you discriminate? Do you discriminate differently in terms of tactility or overtone of material, mm. if you're working in London, mm-hmm. are London people more hard? Are they more vicious? Are people in Scotland less vicious, or whatever it mm-hmm. might be? Mm-hmm. It's a sort of broad question.
Yeah, the difference between architecture and landscape architecture is you have this idea of patina, that the process is going on with your buildings inside and outside. Hereby, so we use it and then we destroy it somehow, and outside the weather is destroying it, but it's much slower than in the landscape. In the landscape, it's much more dynamic. this idea of a process, an ongoing process, and it can destroy, and of course trees can grow, it's not only about destroying. These processes are not so easy to control or to keep in mind when you design it, but it's part of our design process to think about how could it work without us. If maintenance is not good and or it's going in this direction. And especially here in London, I think people know a lot about gardens. It's like in Hamburg, you have a specific tradition about, but it's gardens. It's not much more about gardens and not about this kind of public plazas you have in the Mediterranean or the public parks. You have a tradition in France or in Germany where you have these traditional parks, but here there is this understanding of parks, and we should never forget this tradition. So landscape architects lost their clients after the First World War because they're all relating to kings, and we lost our clients. And I think that's one of the biggest problems, that in the modern architecture we didn't exist. Because it was a shock. So, because all these famous, wonderful English landscape landscape parks relate somehow to an aristocratic tradition, in a very good way. I'm not criticizing it, but we lost these clients, and it wasn't Bedford Square. But then we transformed it somehow. But still, I think we don't have an idea how to define. It's like David Chipperfield talking about common ground, and not so many architects could give a good answer. I think it was an interesting exhibition by David, showing somehow what is the common ground of architecture today, and landscape architecture, or whoever is responsible for the public space. It's not a good discussion we have today, I think. What is really public space, and what are the qualities? And for me, it's all a bit instant gardening, instant design. It has to work from the first day one on. It has to work. It's like Nescafe coming from Switzerland. You have some powder, some hot water, but that's not really an espresso. No, you know, it's instant coffee somehow, and that's the problem. Even our projects, they work from day one. They really work, and that's. Sometimes I try to explain, you know, when all these famous architects, sometimes if you don't have time or they have specific projects, you know who the two people are they really are interested, all of them. Patrick Plon and Peter Rudolph. So these are really good in relating to plants, to vegetation, and it's good from day one on. And it's really, it's not instant gardening, I'm not criticizing it, but you have from the first day, you have a presence of what you see. But when you are talking about processes, it's not so easy, because who is dealing with these processes? And that's not so easy. And I think we don't have really good answers to this. Like Novartis, they expect from there. You know, the biggest trees are 16 meters high, and you can buy it. You know? And sometimes when you see a tree outside, that's really good. With such a tree, you cannot buy time. It's just not possible to buy time. That's we are not able to do. And you see such a tree that we see in every park here, like that, you cannot buy it. It's time. And that's I think, there is a, where we had this tent or this black box just nearby our London plains, and sometimes I do a walk with my students through the city of Zurich to explain my view on it, and then I say, you see, these London plains were planted before Napoleon, and of course they all don't know when Napoleon lived, but it's very old. So, and these trunks are like this, and then to explain, but you can never buy this time. It is, but it is present, and that's not so easy even for me. I think it's sometimes it's not so easy to deal with all these processes, strategies, and it's and it's too fast. We are all too fast on your way, especially for our profession.
I was intrigued by the underground power parks because one doesn't usually think of landscape design as having a vertical dimension with mines and underground tunnels and so on. But it also put me in mind that you have an illustrious forerunner in the area of Stadtlandschaft, which is Hans Scharoun. And Scharoun's vision, I don't think it was ever really fully, his idea for the Hauptstadt Berlin in 1957 with a kind of Stadtberg, a sort of a layering of the city on top of the landscape, on top of the city, on top of the landscape, as a kind of splicing into one another, this vertical dimension, so that you don't know whether you're making the green grey or the grey green. And I wondered if you had any affinity with that forerunner.
We could look at Archigram in the 60s. When I was a student, I thought these guys were crazy, but today it's reality, you know. they are still a bit crazy, but it's reality meanwhile. When you see this car parking for Novartis or the project directory, this scale, I don't know, I think it's 10 times bigger than Amazon today. I can even not imagine such a space. And then, yeah, we are dealing, and you're mentioning Scharoun, but I could say Bruno Taut as well, you know, with this Alpine, because my students are finding out now Super Studio, Archigram, Bruno Taut. And it's interesting that the students are going back and are interested in this concept. And I think it's interesting for them to really study this. But Scharoun, I don't know. Lars Müller just published the Archipelago from Rem Koolhaas and Ungers. So this idea before in the 70s. And for me, what can I say? But Scharoun is special. It's an exceptional discussion. I think we should discuss it afterwards. It's so complex. Yeah.
Sorry. Hi, thank you for your fantastic presentation. I would like to hear more about the park for the Olympic Village. You mentioned that you have a lot of reservation in working for such a big project, and of course we know that the Olympic Village replaced, you know, the Clay's Lane estate, and there was a lot of polemics and around that. So my question is, what is the challenge as a land architect, you know, to inhabit a space like that, to work in a context like that? And so you mentioned that it was very difficult to go back to space, and I'm a bit curious to know more about your involvement with the project.
Mm. Yeah, but what's really interesting there is, if you can work with large scale topic, and in this case it was the rainwater coming down. So all rainwaters on roofs, on streets, on plazas is going into this system, in this ecosystem of this park underneath. So we can treat rainwater, we don't give it away, we really treat it before give it into the River Lee. So in this large scale it really makes sense. And of course it makes sense in the small scale. If hundreds or thousands are doing it, and it's good because so thousand small projects is like a big project. But there you can show it, and you can show it to the people what is the amount of rainwater we have to treat and so on. And I think it's important that we are not becoming too didactic. That's another problem in landscape architecture, not to become too pedagogic or too didactic. So in the end, it's just a park.
to go there, and whatever you do in a park. I don't know what you do in a park. I'm not so often in a park, so sometimes I really feel like a tourist when I look in or go into a park. In my daily life, I never go in a park. It's the only public space I use is the street. I don't have a car, I don't have a bike, so I have to walk or to take public transport. But normally I'm in the street. I'm not so, I'm only with my students in parks. So, because, you know, it's that's, but there it's a wonderful, because it's a big system. It's not only our projects, there are several projects coming in the future. And for me, it's more interesting to have this, let's say, Victoria Park and then the new park. So, by walking through to read the times, a different time, because in the same time, you always have different ideas how a park should look like. It's like sometimes when my students explain, you know, you have the motorway and then you have the railway line, and it's all a bit formless, and sometimes it's not formless. The railway line follows different rules, and it was built in a different time than the motorway. And the motorway, early motorways in the United States are like an English landscape park. The motorway in Germany, mainly built by the Nazis, and in Switzerland mainly built in the 60s, they all follow different rules. There is always, there are rules behind, and you have to understand a landscape like that. In this sense, it fits in a series of different parks, a lot of different times, and that's, for me, that's interesting, to walk through the time.
But there is not also an issue of, in relation to the Olympics, there was this issue of the legacy, but also what was there before. So in a way, this, you know, this kind of how do you negotiate between past and future? Because obviously you are redesigning a landscape which was even very striking before. It was polluted. There was a lot of problem in that area. But at the same time, when I'm thinking about who was living there and have to be evicted. In a way, there is an issue also of recent memory. Mm. Okay, so at the same time, there is the challenge to make this space open to others. So yeah. Mm.
Yeah, but I showed the legacy because I have doubts about our idea of big events. You have it everywhere now. The big events, and in China, it happens without event. So it's. And everybody believes in these big scales. And our students, they really like the big scales, the urban planning in Rio and Mumbai, whatever, or here in London or in Paris. But the problem is, in the end, it's never, nobody follows this urban planning studies. And then it's broken down into small scale, and it's politically difficult. And after 20 years, everybody's looking on it, saying, but who really wanted it? Like that. Yeah. And we were at part of such a not this scale in Zurich. It's more or less built as it was planned, but it's just not good. So, but I could explain, it would take another hour to explain why. Because everybody told us it will be, in terms of economy, it will take 40, 50 years, but then it was built within 15 years. This means a lot. And then we had in the master plan four different parks. The design, individual design competition, three were public plazas, not parks. Wonderful design, but no parks. And then people, and when I'm talking to my colleagues saying, listen, it's a wonderful design, but it's the wrong type. Yeah, but you know, do you, and then ask people living around there, say expected to have lawn, parks, whatever, in a very traditional way. And the density is not high enough. Nobody's talking about how many people do you really need for these large parks. Here I don't see a problem in the legacy. It's really dense around. But I have my doubts about this big urban planning project. Because in the end, we are delivering an image. You know? It's not, and then within the construction period, people are moving out and in. And I don't believe that we can plan it as we think. That's a problem.
But I think the Archetype village was actually, for us, it was very, it was quite exciting because it was like a big model that would be built in real in a very short time. So of course, it was super challenging because we had, you know, very limited time, and also we just had the hit of the economical crisis just in the middle of a design process, which led us to redesign the whole scheme again and again. I mean, I think twice. But at the end of the day, it was also very interesting to have this economical constraint. I think everything was very rough because you had very little time, finally very little budget because it was shrinked down by, I don't know, 40%, I think, something like 30-40%. So we had to deal with very essential elements, and it was topography. I remember the conversation, how can we keep a very good public rim? We have to design it quickly to the people, something that will be much better than the average public rim in London, and especially in East London. So we say, okay, very structural elements like topo, big, very good planting, and loan. Because as Günther says, British people have an erotic relationship to loan. So we need loan, you know, as much as possible, and then very good materials on the sides, like Yorkstone to relate to central London. And at the end of the day, apparently, I mean, the first users of these public rooms have been the athletes during the games, obviously. And apparently it worked very well because at the end of the games, they had a lot of fun and apparently a lot of sexual relationships happened on the lawn, on the topo. And we somehow we've managed, you know, the first... the first step of the project, because people have actually used it very well. So of course, Günther's complaining because it's not open to the public yet. It's going to be open to the public by the end of the year, and I'm sure it's going to work because it, I mean, there's good. There's been a very good start so far.
And who will live there?
Well, we don't know yet. I mean, you're asking me.
Yeah.
The Qataris have bought the development, the entire development. So I don't know what you know they're going to do there. But the open spaces are supposed to remain open and public.
Yeah.
So. Mm.
What there we have to fight for, because I see it everywhere, that public space is being fenced off. Everywhere you see it slowly, slowly. So you really have to pay. You have to have an entrance ticket. You have, and it's coming everywhere. Mm-hmm. Even in China, you have it meanwhile that it's no longer really public or really private. And no, it's more a big event, no? Because everybody told me, no, it's so sustainable, but why do you build a stadium for 80,000 or 90,000 people and rebuild it for 50,000? No? Mm-hmm. Is this sustainable? Not talking about the architecture, all this. I doubt about all this big planning. Are we really able to deal with this scale? Can we control quality? Can we control over such a long period or lead all the processes going on? It's not critical against London or the London Olympics. It's more because in Brazil it's the same. They have the champion, world football championship, and then the Olympics, and all these big events. So they have to do a lot in building infrastructures, whatever. It's really the question, is it really helpful to have these big investments related to one event going on for 4 weeks? And when I see the money being invested, why do we need, I'm a big football fan, but why do we need these events? Why do we really, because we are talking about 10, 20 billions of pounds. Are we not, we are not able, it's only because the event, it has to happen in London in 2012, so we have to finish it. Otherwise it would not work, and it's the same everywhere. No? And that shows a little bit that we are not able to handle all this process. That's only my. It's not really critical against it. It's more thinking: shouldn't we change this approach on the big scale, or rethink? So.
Is there no other questions? I think we leave the session with the question posed by Günther. Thank you very much for you coming to the event.
Thank you.